Okay, our next speaker is Professor Rosario Macari. He's a professor of transport planning and engineering in Lisbon. And he is an international expert as well. He's a member of the steering committee of WCRS, the World Conference on Transport Research Society for Long, and he is the editor-in-chief of one of the important Elsevier journals. This is Case Studies on Transport Policies. And she has done a lot of international research, not only in Europe, but in Latin America, Africa, Asia. So the floor for you, please.
Thank you. Good morning, and thank you very much for inviting me for this conference, which is also always a very interesting opportunity to interact with different experiences and persons. So as Alid said, I'm a professor of the University of Lisbon, and also from the University of Antwerp in Belgium. So let me... We have been talking and we have seen already three presentations about planning. And planning is an instrument, I think no one disagrees from this. And it is an instrument that has to be used with a very specific objective. And here is the first thing we have to change from the last decades. Our objective is not mobility. We move because we need to have good access, and because access gives us opportunities to reach activities and to develop. Access is also a function of land use and transport, and we have said this in the beginning of the session. And we have thousands of pages written about this, integration between land use and transport. But we all recognize that it doesn't happen. And it doesn't happen for two reasons. One, because very often our institutional and organizational design doesn't allow that to happen. That is, doesn't define well the functions that have to be executed at each decision level. And another one is because we have a traditional silo-oriented organization. And we tend to take decisions within the silos and never across the silos. And transport accessibility, it's really at the border of different domains. And different domains that are typically within our institutional settings, that are typically closed within silos. And so, this means that we have access and the function of integration between land use and transport is not working well because we are not able to have a vertical and a transversal coherency in terms of decisions. And so we take fragmented decisions within different silos, within different decision levels, without taking into account that each decision that is taken is going to affect the other areas, the other departments, the other domains. So transport, being a simple thing, is in fact a function of many different domains, physical, logical, financing, organizational, regulatory. I could have maybe 10 more here that would not be exhaustive. Well, accessibility itself is in fact a downside and an upside. And social exclusion is clearly the downside of accessibility. So we can identify from the different cases around the world that there is a number of access-related barriers that are generating social exclusion. The availability of physical accessibility, the cost of transport, the location of the services in inaccessible places. In several countries, we can see industrial parks, service parks, that are only served by roads, that are not served by public transport. Safety and security, the fear of crime, sometimes even the travel horizons, that is people on low income areas that are found to be less willing to travel to access the work and than those on higher income levels. So there is a very extensive outreach of this problem in terms of a consequence of the lack of accessibility. And it is a consequence that spread across the society and that has a tremendous impact both from the social and from the economic point of view. There is an upside, of course, and we are glad that it exists and that we can observe it also in several countries. Social inclusion is much better achieved if we have equity of access. And this depends very much on the combination of what we can call the intelligent integration between land use and transport and environmental aspects and income distribution. We see many cities talking about bicycles. We see many cities saying that they are going to invest in bicycles, that they can put a bicycle lane just beside the road. Excellent. But in fact, if we just do this, and if we just increase the offer of bicycles, but we don't change the rest that we have, we are just killing cyclists, because we are exposing the cyclists to a very high degree of pollution. So, which means that it's not only bringing the active modes or the soft modes into the field. No, we have to change. The change is much more deeper than just bringing soft modes to the floor. So, we need to increase equity in society, and accessibility is a critical factor of equity. We need to raise the productive potential of society. Today, this is already part of the list of selection, the list of criteria for companies to select the location of their offices. It is, in fact, the quality of accessibility. How much time is going to be lost by their employees? How much time their directors are going to lose within congestion? We need to reduce the friction of conflicts and potential conflicts between the groups in society. The reality of the city, the urban reality, is almost a miracle. How we are able to make fit so many people with so different interests and so conflicting interests inside a restricted area. That is the space that we have. And we have to reduce this level of friction. But what we know now from the last 10, 20 years, I would say, or even more, of trying to understand why somehow our paradigm of evolution failed, what we learn is that a socially inclusive urban transport system is much more costly than what we have in the traditional approach, because it's not only a transport system. It has to be focused on the value creation for the users, because our societies have a criteria of choice that is embedded in our societies. The users want to have choice, and the users want to have acceptable and adequate choices for what are their needs. And so, developing a socially inclusive urban transport is, in fact, an expensive element. We have two sides of the same coin. We need to balance the discussion and to stress that for full participation in the society, we have to consider other conditions, and not only transport. So we have to be more transversal. The solution cannot be inside transport. Inside the transport, the domain of transport, we have exhausted the solution that could enable us to improve, that is cost reduction. We cannot continue to force that that solution. We have reached the limit. And reaching the limit of going beyond the limit can be very dangerous, because we will see then companies starting to hiding costs, cutting costs, and we will have then the regulation of those consequences very often in safety and security. Transport may be by itself a factor of exclusion, and this is clear. It has an environmental and a physical impact, and the negative impacts tend to be concentrated in more deprived areas. So transport is going to be a major for deprived areas, and it's going to be a major for exclusion. This is a consequence of the fact that the transport infrastructure not only benefits if it is strategically well designed and planned, but it also can also degrade the surrounding areas if we don't take into account the other elements of this issue. Lack of transport is clearly identified as a factor of degradation, and a factor of degradation that is going to subtract value to both land use and business development. So we have here a kind of two phases. In one hand, if it is well done, strategically oriented, if it considers the other domains, it can be an added value. If it does not, it can be an element of degradation. So, in fact, what we need to address is focus on accessibility, because accessibility is the turning point, it's the corner for the choice between social inclusion or social exclusion. This is Portugal, for the ones who do not know. So, a very small country. We have about 700 kilometers of length and 200 kilometers of wide. In the widest part, we reach 300 and something. And you can see a good example of, with such a dimension, look at the list of authorities we have for transport. And this was the typical example of fragmented decision. And we have understood that this was leading us to unfeasible solutions for transport. So, since the beginning of the century, there was a decision on starting to obtain critical mass and starting to obtain integrated decisions in relation to transport. In the last years in particular, we have been successful in the first 5 years of the century and in improving significantly the mobility of the different cities. But we understood that we could not continue to work only within the transport sector. So after 2010, there were a number of plans that have been approved, strategies and national directives in land use, environment, energy, transport, and road safety altogether. So it was the first time that we started to address an integrated logic and an integrated perspective. We have developed regional land use plans for the whole country, and we have reviewed all the municipal plans. There was government support with several studies and a global program done for 40 municipalities on sustainable mobility projects. These were the, let's say, the pilot municipalities to start the decision. We have benefited also from the fund of the National Strategic Reference Framework between 2007-2013, and which has financed a significant number of mobility plans, but not only the mobility plans. So we did not only tick the box on doing mobility plans, but we in fact did an intensive program of capacitation of our municipalities. So it was again a global strategy that was established through several guiding documents which have been designated as mobility package. And the word package is not by chance here. The word mobility package is in fact because the message we wanted to transmit was that the decision has to be transversal and the decision has to include a set of coherent measures that will lead to the designated objective. Which guidelines have we produced? National directives for mobility, guidelines for the implementation of accessibility, mobility and transport in municipal plans for land use, guidelines for mobility plans, a wide set of leaflets or details for capacitation of specific details, like green areas, crossings, etc. Guidelines for cooperative mobility plans and technical and financial support for the capacitation of all this. We have been able to pass four important messages. The first one is that planning and managing mobility implies assuming that potential options often materialize by arbitrage between private interests. That is, we cannot think that we can solve mobility just simply by giving guidelines and strategies from bottom down, from top down. We have to negotiate, we have to be able to encompass the private interests within the planning. And this is one of the several reasons why decision makers have to change their procedure and their attitude. That is, they must involve very early in the definition of strategic orientation. And we must clearly divide what are strategic decisions and strategic guidelines from what is the planning, the tactical level of action, that is, the finding of the solutions to achieve the strategic objectives. The approach to pedestrian spaces and the path as a value asset, both for a smooth intermodal solutions and also for urban proximity and for the increase of the quality of life in urban proximity. Very often we talk about intermodality and we just forget what is a very important piece of intermodality, that is the fact that people walk to reach the first mode of transport and people have to walk in between as well. The concept of sustainable mobility, we have passed the message that this concept demands that the transport system must have the following major objectives: contain the use of the private car, increase the use of public transport, and increase active mobility with soft modes. And these are three objectives that drive all the other actions in terms of planning and in terms of definitions of strategic options. Well, what you see here is a diagram that is a very simple diagram that tells more or less what we all know, but what most of the cities do not practice. That is the understanding that for each point where I am in the city, I should be able to have an intelligent view of my accessibility to the rest of the city. That is, look at the city from my place, from the place where I am. And this has to be done from all the places in the city. And what you see, the dark point in the center is if you walk. So if you walk, typically, you can walk about 2 kilometers, 4 kilometers can be the maximum. If you go on the bus, well, 7.5 kilometers should be acceptable. If you take a bicycle, you can go up to 10 kilometers if you have a flat area. If you have the underground, then you can extend to 12 kilometers. And so forth, and with the different modes. So we have looked at the city in this perspective, that is, what are the conditions of accessibility from this point onwards? And we have considered these standards, let's say, of distances for the different modes to be articulated in the city. What are the guidelines for 2010-2020 for all the SUMPs, so all the Sustainable Urban Mobility Plans? Develop networks of centrality, articulated with networks of accessibility, ensure intermunicipal municipality continuity, contain urban sprawl, so invite people back to live in the city, structure the accessibility networks integrating low-density areas, densification of urban use, value proposition to the interfaces, so not being only an interface but offering additional functions, promote corridors for public transport and soft modes, develop and upgrade pedestrian networks, and manage parking also. This is what you can see the difference in this map between what is, in the case of Lisbon, what is the difference of accessibility from 97 to 2007. So accessibility is here, the green areas are time in minutes and how what you can reach, and the red areas are the work in terms of accessibility. And from the picture of 97 to 2007, you see an increase of what is about more than 50% in terms of improvement of accessibility in this area. What reflections for the future do we have? What have we learned from looking at cities of South America, Africa, Asia, and Europe? We see that more and more cities are enforcing mobility plans. We see just a very reduced number of cities forcing these mobility plans to be taken in an integrated way with land use. And we see also only a very reduced number of cities making the difference between what are the strategic definition of the objectives and what are the planning actions to ensure transversal decision and transversal plans in an integrated way. So as we have said, we have to ensure a top-down strategic assessment and strategic logic in terms of governance and in terms of definition of the mobility plans, but we have to compromise this with the private interests that are at the micro level and that are very often conflicting. Today, the decision maker has to have the balance and to balance this compromise between these two logics. What we don't have in most cities still is this. The urban mobility system requires a new planning process, and it requires a new planning process that cannot start at a tactical level as we typically do. It has to start at the strategic level and has to start at this higher level. We see often in anywhere in the world, in the developed and developing countries, we see decision makers coming to the TV, going to the newspaper and saying, the city office is going to have an underground. The city office is going to have a BRT. The city office is going to have a tram. The tram is very fashionable. This is always the wrong decision process that is behind this. We do not have a clear assessment of the problems. We do not have a clear definition of what are the objectives that would definitely improve the city. And only from those objectives down to the system, to the tactical level, to the operational level, we are then able to find what are the best solutions for these type of problems. And we very often are seeing the implementation of systems that are misfitting the situation that they have. That they are implemented in places where they do not have the density to be to have a viable operation, or they simply are not adequate to the needs of the place where they are implemented. So the urban mobility systems, they need something with a new planning process, a planning process that starts in the strategic level, that is coherent along the different levels of decision, and that is transversal to the whole domains, because the mobility system and the accessibility is in the border of all these domains. So we need interaction between entities. We need structural consistency, so in this vertical and this transversal view, because decisions are in fact lying in the border of the domains that usually represents our autonomous silos that we have our organization prepared. We don't have, and we should not try to have, universal solutions. Each city differs, and each city has to find its own objectives, its own logic of development. But we need to have articulated process that over time are able to build what we call institutional trust that allows private entrepreneurs to invest and to help the development of the cities together and in partnership with the state and the government. And thank you for your attention.